Avatar.
Baba DJ.
So this is the seventh of our eight sessions. The topic today being the human on the human form. Meher Baba has said that the human form is the only form in creation. In this session, we will examine the archetypal human form and its relation to what we call subtle physiology, which is to say, microcosm, macrocosm correspondences, the human form in evolution and involution, structure of the self, as explained in Meher Baba's 1943 booklet, Divine Deen, the relation between the perfect man, Al-Ansan Al-Kamo, and the five presences, as it's called, and the different types of God-realized persons, or Shivatma. So we'll cover some of that in a minute. But the core of this is the human form and its significance. And this is a topic that I kept bumping into in the course of going through Baba's books, including editing some of this material. And it seems very clear that the human form is indeed deeply significant. But Baba never really explained it in a complete way. So what we have are like hints or indications or teasers. So I'm just going to review some of what I've seen. But I think this will be a topic that will be important in the future. I mean, it occurs to my mind right off the bat to people whose work involves the human form, like doctors or practitioners, medical practitioners. It would certainly be relevant. And many other kinds of fields, too. I mean, it will ultimately be relevant. That the human form is has deep significance. Here is, and this afternoon, the final session, we'll be talking about the 10 states of God. Angela? Which is the ninth, and also the final chapter, part 10. The 10 states of God is part 9, which concludes there. Concludes the book, and I think the 10 states of God, in fact, culminates God Speaks. Let me flash an image here. Like many other people, I've always been struck by this. On the left-hand side, Leonardo da Vinci's famous Vitruvian Man, actually, this is only part of the picture, but he inscribed this within a circle. You probably are acquainted with that. Do you have a really good image of it anywhere, John? A really good image of this, the Vitruvian
Man? Yeah, I have an image of it, yeah.
I'd like to get a really good scene.
Yeah,
okay. That's why I did.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I have one.
And he was interested in matters of the proportionality of the human form and the meaningfulness of all of that. And we're using this in one of the images in different lectures here, which I'll get to presently. Here is some of what Baba comments about the human form from early to late. Sorry, it's a little bit small. I'll get bigger versions in future presentations. Though Meher Baba never treated the topic in one place systematically, scattered allusions over the course of his life make it clear that he did indeed invest the human form with symbolic or archetypal or paradigmatic significance, though it is hard to discover a single scheme or frame of reference that explains all that he said. But Meher Baba did make it clear that the human form is inherent in every form in creation. Indeed, in the process of evolution, as he described it, the process of evolution, as he described it, consists in the progressive unfoldment of the human form that is latent in evolution from the very beginning. This theme finds clear expression in an article published in the Mihir Message in 1929. Here's that quote. Though there are millions of nominal forms through which the soul has to pass before it can incarnate in the human form, yet, strictly speaking, there is only one form, viz. The human form, from the beginning to the end. And why? Just before the human form, and it should be just as, I copied this exactly from the article. This is an article attributed to Mihir Baba in Mihir Message.
Where is this article? The whole article?
I have the full reference somewhere, but it's in this magazine called the Mihir Message, which was a monthly publication starting in January 1929, running through 1931. But I have the Schlitz reference somewhere or other.
But this page that you have there?
This is an essay that, this will appear as one of the appendices in Tiffin lectures.
Okay, so it's one of the Tiffin lectures.
That reviews subtle physiology. I wrote the appendix as a whole, trying to collect different references the Baba made to this topic of human form.
In the Tiffin lectures, all this.
And other places. They're scattered in diaries. They're scattered references all over the place to bits and pieces. The whole picture doesn't ever get explained anywhere by Baba. There'll probably be masters who will come along and explain it, or maybe some of you can, you know, clarify certain bits and pieces. I mean, that certainly can happen. And why? Just as previous forms, just as the human form is latent in all the previous forms, including the electron. But in order that the human form may be completely manifested, the soul has to pass through all the different countless forms. There are 8,400,000 in evolution, actually, in the evolution of species you pass through. In other words, the different forms in the mineral, vegetable, and animal kingdoms are nothing but the human form in its latent state. And, a quarter century later, Mihir Baba expressed the same idea again in God Speaks, where he says, strictly speaking, there is only one form, the human form, which is latent in all of the previous forms. The mineral, the plant, and the animal forms actually contain the human form in its latent state. And this is gradually and increasingly manifested until at last it is completely expressed as a human being in a human body. Now, so far as I know, this is new information in spiritual history. The significance, the archetypal significance of the human form has often been indicated in various religious spiritual traditions, like in the Torah, man is made in the image of God, for example. Or I'll come later to the notion of al-insan al-kamal. The perfect man, which gets developed in Sufism, particularly Ibn Arabi and Jami and others, and great significance is attached to the human in many other ways, not just the physical form. And in yogic traditions, the human body is studied for various significances that it has. I'm no big expert in these things, but some of you, are any of you aware of other traditions in which the human body is taken as a microcosm to some cosmic reality? It's all over the place, that much I know. So Baba has really gone further than that. He's gone not just to say that the human form mirrors God, but that it's inherent in everything, and that's all that there is. In fact, in this next quote, it goes, as Baba went on to explain in the Mirror Message article, Every stone has eyes, nose, mouth, hands, and feet. In fact, a complete body, exactly like a human body. But it is compact to the last degree. It is extremely latent in this form. It is like a cloth doll, which can be made to resemble an uneven piece of stone when it is carefully folded up. There was a scene in the movie The Lord of the Rings where they're at the gates of Mordor and they're about to be caught with Frodo and Sam by orcs. And they have this robe which Galadriel gave them, and they fold up and they cover it, and it looks exactly like a stone. And it really made me think of this. So this is the root of the topic this morning, then, the human form and its significance.
In some Persian painting, probably you artists can answer this question. Some of the rocks, you can see the image of things, animals or humans.
Yeah. Now, one of the important treatments of this that never really got reproduced again elsewhere is once again Ramju Abdullah. And it would seem that Baba gave explanations about all of this back in the 20s and only referred to it a bit later on. And it's a bit confused. I've really looked at various sources and can't fully work it out. But one of the facts of evolution would seem to be that the human form goes through five turns. Five movements. And in the course of it, the human form goes from a recumbent position. I wish we had somebody who had studied yoga, who probably do this beautifully, but if you can imagine that, somebody lying down, and I'm not sure whether... Just lie flat. Now, this is Angie the Stone. Now, for the first movement, Angie, please stand on your head. Yeah, okay. So that's the plant form, with the head down and the feet up in the air. That's what a tree is. In fact, to go all the way, please put your head beneath the flooring so that your neck is right at the bottom. That's what a tree has its head under the ground, actually. But okay, then coming back, the next big movement is you flop down from tree form to on your belly again, like a worm. There's the worm. And now, I'm not entirely sure what the next turn is. It's always confused. But maybe there's some kind of a yogic thing where your bottom comes up or something. I'm not quite sure what it is. They didn't know what you were in for this morning. Good the kids aren't here. Maybe something like, yeah, maybe it's something like this.
Like that?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
That's the cat.
Cat.
Or that little caterpillar kind of thing that comes up in the loop. You know, a caterpillar will come up sometimes in the loop and then slide out flat again.
It might be that, I'm not sure. But then the next one is then your rump would come down and your come down this. Like that. And then you rise up like a human being. I don't know how you do it exactly. That's it. And now, here we go. Thank you. And now we've got this. Good, the kids weren't here.
What is Mum doing?
So, Ward, why did you say that the tree's head is in the ground?
Because it is. It's the human form upside down. Where the
Father mentioned it.
Yeah, and it's right here in Roger's book. It's explained a number of places, Baba said it quite explicitly.
The
mouth is the root. You're drinking, but you're underground.
The mouth is the hair and the roots.
Yeah, the hair of the roots are
the
like...
The roots are hair, the mouth are slightly above the ground.
No, the throat is actually at the ground level.
Yeah, under the ground.
The throat is the... So if you're cut down a tree, you're cutting the throat. And then the hands and feet are branches. In fact, Baba said there is some tree.
Date palm.
Is it the date palm?
Oh, palm tree, yeah.
That has exactly four major branches.
No, it's the moss, it's above the ground.
Oh.
It's the date palm.
But in general, he says the mouth is under the ground, sucking nutrients and water from the ground. It's the head.
But the roots are almost like the dendrites of the in the brain. Uh-huh. They almost give that neural connection. If you
maybe
see
so.
The connection, you know, like the way that nerves connect.
I see.
And then they also, we heard the other day on the radio, that trees communicate with each other, they discovered, through their roots. Now, in not just the same species. But a number of species that they can actually sort of pass something to do with within the environment, that they do actually connect as a group.
I see. So they talk underground because they're that's where their heads are. No, all of this could be. There will probably be a new branch of science or maybe new mystics who will see the human form and see like the brain, the neurons or whatever it is of the brain expressing themselves as roots.
Throughout the art history, there's quite a few depictions of trees upside down.
Are there?
Yeah.
In the Bhagavad Gita, there's a very famous tree in it. It's an upside down tree, though, so I won't try to explain it. So then, when you come, that's the first turn from being recumbent in rock and metal form to an upside down posture in the plant kingdom. But then your feet come down and you collapse. And in fact, let's read from Ramju. This is the fullest explanation of this topic that I've ever seen. I'll read this first one and somebody else pick it up. 8,400,000 bubbles or forms which the Atma is proverbially said to pass through, and it's actually species. This number comes from Indian tradition. It goes all the way back to the Upanishads anyway. And Baba did, are the chief forms or genera, actually genuses, each of which has its numberless species. And the Atman has to pass through all of them before it can incarnate in the human form. Yet, strictly speaking, there is only one form, viz. The human form, because it is latent in all the previous forms, including the electron. In other words, the different forms in the mineral, vegetable, and animal kingdoms are nothing but the human form in its latent state, which becomes completely manifested as the human body, being a human being. Would somebody like to carry us on for a paragraph or two?
The compact latent human form takes four straight turns, and afterwards one inverse turn, in all five turns.
So this is a persistent theme. There are five turns in evolution. That's right. And God speaks us there too.
Before it becomes completely manifested. In order to understand these five terms, we must glance at some of the species.
Okay, and here you see it with its five terms.
Stone is the first important form, which is visible to the naked eye. Every stone has eyes, nose, mouth, hands, and feet. In fact, a complete body, exactly like the human body. But as it is compact to the last degree, it is extremely latent in this form. It is like the cloth doll, which can be made to resemble an uneven piece of stone when it is carefully folded up. with the evolution from the stone, these imperceptible compact parts of its body begin getting unfolded. In the metal kingdom, they are still invisible to the naked eye, but in the vegetable kingdom, the crude manifestation of the latent form is perceptible to some extent.
You keep going?
The latent form in the stone evolves with the head going towards the ground and the feet rising up, gradually becoming upside down in
vegetable kingdom.
The vegetable kingdom, with the head completely underneath the ground and the feet straight up, as in the case of the tree. Ah, here's the first form. The tree form is the first form of this latent human form.
The first turn.
Oh, the first.
Of the five turns, this is the first one.
Yeah.
So what a turn seems to me is a turn of the human body, particularly with respect to verticality or horizontality. So it's turning from recumbent to upside down.
The first turn of this latent human form. Observe a tree carefully. The mesh of roots are the hairs on the head of the tree. The mouth is there, though latent, and so it is not seen by the naked eye. Water and manure are given to the trees in order that they may drink and eat at their bottoms and not on their tops, for their mouths are underneath the ground. The entire portion from throat upwards of the body of every tree stands out on the ground. The entire portion from throat upwards of the body of every tree stands out on the ground.
Means above the ground.
Yeah. The lowest visible portion of the trunk is the throat of the tree, and the remaining trunk is its main body. The bigger branches are its hands and feet, and the smaller branches are the fingers of its hands and feet.
Yes, and Baba did say that there is some kind of tree that has four main branches, and each main branch has smaller branches, thus mirroring human form with our two arms, two legs, and five fingers or toes on each limb. So there's a form that's just like that. He didn't say what form it was, though.
With the evolution from the vegetable kingdom, the feet of the crudely manifested inverse human form in the tree gradually comes down and down as the soul passes through different forms until they, the feet, lie flat on the ground in the form of a worm whose mouth is upwards and not underneath the ground. This is the second turn.
Now I have a little bit of a hard time with the different references to this. I mean, I would think a worm is on its belly, but does this mean that it's in fact on its back, its mouth upwards? Mm-hmm. Is anybody here intimately acquainted with worms?
Yeah.
But aren't insects also included in this?
What's that?
Aren't insects also?
Yes, worms includes insects, yeah. Reptiles, everything. So I would think they would tend to be belly down.
But they tend to hold their heads up.
Yes.
Well, the worms obviously.
Yeah.
They poke their heads out.
And you know, Baba attaches a lot of significance to the position of the head and whether the eyes are turned up or down. Apparently that's an important fact. Okay, do we have anybody who's feeling worm-like? Jeff, are you feeling a worm today? Curious. From worm upwards?
Right. From the worm stage, the latent form begins to rise again with face up. Its third turn, say from an angle of 60 degrees, occurs in the fish form, whose feet are down, but the other part of whose body is raised.
Now 60 degrees, I would presume that would mean like that, right? Not like that. Fish aren't vertical to that extent. I'm not an expert on any of these critters, but there's a certain vertical.
Do fish have eyes?
High.
It's high up in the mouth and not in.
Yeah.
The eyes are up here.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so he's going to talk about that here.
even when the fish dives down into the water, its eyes remain turned up.
This is what you're consistent with what you're saying.
Which may be contrasted to those of a human being whose eyes, while diving, are turned downward. The wings of every fish.
Never mean the fins. This is by Ranju, and in those days they would call toes fingers and stuff like that. The language was not altogether perfected.
Are its compact hands and feet. The last fish form is the waterfowl, in which this latent form is found to be so
somewhat
erect, and the third turn is completed.
So I guess the third turn then would be from horizontality up to a slight incline. Is that how it sounds to you? With a somewhat raising of the head. This is probably the most developed explanation of this topic of the five turns. Now the fourth one, I just can't understand at all. So I'm going to take us on a journey.
Once again, through through various changes, comes the fourth turn, with face downwards in the shape of a crab.
Now, what does that mean? Can anyone figure that out? I can't figure that out at all.
Just a little crab, so I suppose, coming from water to land.
Yeah.
It's like stalks, so that's interesting. That its face is down, its mouth is down.
Yeah. So I guess there's a change from face up to face down. Yeah,
with some crabs they've got their body, but their eyes are still on the top of the
head.
And some crabs have actually got like almost a little kind of arm that comes out with the eyes on top of the arm.
Yeah, stalk with an eye on top of it. Mm-hmm. I almost wonder if this isn't garbled.
Yeah.
I didn't take this wrong.
Yeah, maybe the turtle something, because according to the Hindu mythology, the turtle was the thing that came out first from the water.
Yeah.
And then came the fish, kutch and much, what they say. So maybe I think it's, you know, put upside down or...
But I would have thought that a crab would have been earlier in the evolutionary series than a waterfowl.
Or is it purely just the shape of a crab, which,
according to the
I guess, is kind of similar to what
crawled out. Then came the fish.
Look at the face shape there.
Maybe, but the face is turned down, it says. That's the moon crab form.
Yeah, like dogs and horses and cows and
new faces.
It's
with much more senses too.
Yeah.
This may be the most complete dealing with the subject in the extant literature, but it also strikes me as easily the most primitive.
Yeah.
And it's written at the level of animal fables, basically, that which was part of folklore and which was probably not the sort of outline Baba would give to a Western world at all. But you get into hopeless confusion if you try and make some sort of evolutionary progress through time out of this, or even to make logical sense of it, it seems to me.
Well, the thing is that it comes up again in God Speaks, so it seems to be a point that Baba wanted to make about evolution.
Yeah.
Baba was silent when he was giving this to Ramji.
I presume Baba dictated this to Ramji. We have it in another handwritten version of Ramji's. But it's not very helpful. It's not any better than
no,
this.
No, but what I mean is that if he was spelling out on the alphabet board, I thought if he was gesturing, that something like crab and turtle could have been confused.
I mean, it's very possible that something got garbled here.
Yeah,
that does happen sometimes. I really wonder that about the fourth turn. And none of the descriptions of the fourth turn. The others are pretty
clear.
And the fifth is good too.
I think you know, nothing and everything Baba also gives a description. I don't think Baba used the crap in that.
Yeah.
But
it's just talking
to
you.
Yeah,
Ian? I couldn't quite hear some of the comments earlier, but.
Yeah.
Is he not just saying Is he trying to just get us to think about, well, that's how a crab can look, rather than the crab being the next, you know, part of...
Yeah, it's just the shape.
I think he's talking about the shape of,
yeah,
as opposed to the species itself.
Because he's not saying the crab form.
Yeah.
He said the fish form.
I
the
see.
Form.
Okay.
So he's trying to get us to think about
the form of
what
the
they
crab.
Are living in Unga-Nunga and that sort of thing, that the shape of the crab is... All
rather than saying that that species is actually...
Yeah.
Yeah, that could be.
So the actual shape of a crab, if you picture the shape of a crab and take its legs off, it's probably... It does resemble like a... What we would refer to as like a heart-shaped face.
It could be. It could be something like that. You know, the thing is, Ramju was writing up the notes that he took, and Baba might have given them once very quickly, and he didn't really understand it. I mean, all that is there with these
because
things.
Eric said sometimes that Baba would give something,
and
then he didn't get time to write it up till later,
right.
So that it had to save memory.
Could be a turtle, because turtle is a secret animal in Chinese,
the only thing is that it sounds like this is later in the evolutionary series. We've gotten to waterfowls, you know, we've gotten into the bird kingdom.
Yeah, the whole bird kingdom could be that crab that
sometimes
looks like, because the next is the kangaroo. It looks like that's where the bird kingdom belongs.
But the further question is, what kind of movement are we talking about? Because apparently, the movement of the human form as it rises up is what Baba wants to be talking about. Well, let's go on from here.
Sorry,
I mean, it's fairly obvious that the waterfowl is not a fish.
Mm-hmm.
And what Baba's talking about is its movement through water. As a sort of culmination of those creatures who move through water. But he's not talking about an evolutionary development that makes it come from the fishes. I mean, it doesn't make sense at all.
I think it may have something, to do with the feet. Because with the fish, we don't have feet. And then he talks about the feet remain in a compressed form. So now you have the emerging feet from the fish.
Which the bird can be
when you start, it's still compressed and it's
right.
Still, the feet are beginning and your movement
and
changes its whole paradigm from there.
Baba's sequence of the kingdom does go from fish to bird. As you go from water to air is the dominant elements.
Mm.
So birds are dinosaurs.
Mm. No, dinosaurs actually worm.
I think it's a worm form or something.
But they had feathers.
See, Baba said stone could not move, though it had form and life. It was compact and the present. The plant kingdom had life, but it couldn't move. There was no movement.
Yeah, that's right.
It was fixed in a place.
Yeah.
Now the thing that crawled out of the water, the turtle, that was the first species which moved according to the evolution. And then came the fish, which was again in the water but couldn't get out, and then the birds and the humans, you know. So that is probably, like you said, garbled the sequence of events.
And one thing to bear in mind about Baba's account of evolution is it's not necessarily going to appear in any one planet in that sequence. You know, this could be something that occurs as the soul moves around the universe from one place to another.
I think I recall Francis talking about now when they were doing the stuff in God Speaks about the actual sequence of animals and what that he was asking them, asking Eric, oh, which one comes next to it? He wasn't particularly concerned at this point.
It could have to do with something to do with inverse time, because so far till the crab form is all gradually upwards. Suddenly it's face downwards when the inverse turn starts.
Now I'm wondering if, I might have told Angie to do the wrong thing. Maybe the head comes up first, and then the process of getting up. Here, I'll do it myself. I'm going to make her do it. Maybe you go like that, and maybe there's something like that.
You know,
as preparatory as standing.
You know, when Baba sometimes helps the mass.
What do you think?
When the mass is stuck in between the third and the fourth hand, Baba doesn't directly push him into the fourth. Baba pushing down, you know, dragging down to the third, and then push him up to the face.
Yeah.
So this inverse turn
could be because the face is turned down again instead of being turned up. Okay, well let's keep going to the finish.
Then there's also the plant form and the rock and that in the earth,
right.
And then to the water, and
right.
Then up into the air.
Yeah,
you know,
and that's a significant thing. Mm. Yeah, do you want to carry us on through, Jeff, to the human form?
I wouldn't be surprised if you know, reading it, you notice what an emphasis Bart was putting on gravity and the relationship of living things to gravity, which of course is just a space-time distortion of energy, not really even understood what it is. So a deep significance in consciousness playing games with gravity here is underlined all this,
mm-hmm.
rather than any strict scientific categories of evolution. Mm-hmm. Bart is not particularly concerned about those. From the fourth turn, the feet remain in a compressed form till the inverse turn takes place. The fifth turn takes place in the kangaroo form, and it is inverse because the head begins rising up and manifesting itself. The principal manifestations of the latent human form in the animal kingdom are those of the kangaroo, the dog, and the monkey. The kangaroo is the first animal form in which the soul incarnates after passing through the last bird form, and that is why its front two legs are so very small. With further progress, the feet begin to get higher and higher, as in bears, lions, etc. But the eyes remain turned downwards till the dog form. The latent human form can actually sit on its hind legs. The last stepping stone which helps the latent human form in completely manifesting itself is the monkey. The fifth turn is completed in the human form, which is its complete manifestation.
Okay, so that's the fullest description of the five turns that I've ever been able to find anywhere. And it's suggestive, but it's not complete, doesn't seem to me. Yeah.
When Baba did this in the 1920s in India, I don't imagine a lot of Indians would have been aware of the kangaroo.
Oh no, they were in the colonies. They knew all about it.
Did they?
They did.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, Ramju, I mean, Rustam went to Australia, didn't he, in the
1920s? Wasn't allowed to land.
Maybe from his boat he could see a kangaroo hopping around. But this shows how important Australia is, because if we didn't get the kangaroo, you would never get our human form at all.
But in one account somewhere, has anyone read this, that Baba said the last bird form was the pelican.
Yeah.
And the next form was the kangaroo.
Yeah, that's
right. Yeah, I read that somewhere.
But isn't Australia also known as the oldest continental in the world?
Yeah.
Most ancient one.
Okay.
Australia.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Now here's the account of it that is given in God Speaks. Let's see, sorry, it's a bit on the small side. I can expand it somewhat. This is in the 10 States of God. Before the human form becomes completely manifested in a human body, such as a man or a woman, the latent human form makes a series of partial turns. In the crystal and rock state, such as granite, the latent human form is completely upside down. And this looks like this is a mistake to me. Either this is or Ramju's is, because as Ramju described it, it's not completely upside down, but it's just kind of lying there. Incumbent. Erich wrote this, by the way. Or John, maybe what you're saying, maybe Baba was being just kind of quick and not going through it carefully or something. I don't know.
I actually think he asked for some scientific chart to
be presented so he could.
Some,
Yeah.
Some evolutionary thing to base it on.
Yes. It's completely, and it's almost so in the plant state as well. As the forms progress or evolve, the axis of the body rotates slowly so that it becomes more and more horizontal. And when we reach the higher vertebrates, we find the head rising up more and more as the axis of the body approaches the vertical. And then in women, we find the human form completely expressed and completely vertical. The details of this evolution of form are extremely complex. There are, for example, certain species of stone, metal, plant, and animal that have what Meher Baba described as a special seat in evolution. The term Barzak gets used for this. And by the way, the word Barzak actually has a much, much bigger meaning than just this one. It's kind of a very significant term. We could call the avatar as the Barzak between God and creation. A Barzak is something that links, both separates and links two different domains. So this use of Barzak is one very limited application.
Did you say the other day that Baba did indicate what all the Barzaks were between all the kingdoms?
I've not seen a complete list, but I've seen certain ones.
Yeah, me too. Two, yeah. Three, or four in different places.
But here he says, these key species of forms are mostly those that are milestones in the evolutionary journey, and they mark the first and last of certain general class of forms. Somewhere, okay, he says, responding to your point, Meher Baba tells us this whole theme has been explained down to the last detail in his own book. It is still to be handed over to
that'll solve all the problems.
Yeah, so they mark the first and last of certain general classes of species of forms. For example, the first species of bird form to follow the last species of fish form, and the first species, I mean, that sounds like waterfowl. We were talking about that earlier. It would be the first species of bird form following bird form as a Barzak. And the first species of animal form to follow the last species of bird form, and that sounds like that would be the kangaroo, as he was talking about, have a special seat significance in evolution. So this is another topic that needs to be unpacked and explored a lot. We just have some hints from Baba and how to go with it. And let me say again, the evolution that Baba is talking about may very well manifest itself across the canvas of the entire universe. And there's no guarantee that that sequence will exhibit itself as Baba has described it on one planet. I mean, it could be that if you're, you know, that you're a last form of fish and you know, you want to become a waterfowl, this planet you're on ain't any good for that.
Yeah.
So you go to another planet.
Yeah.
And then, you know, 500 million years later, on the planet you were at, suddenly a new string of forms becomes available.
Yeah.
So on a particular planet, you might not see this sequence.
That's right.
Order.
In that film, Mars Attack, they look quite different.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
They took good photographs of the original form. Here's another aspect to this whole evolution that is part of this picture too, and that is, I won't read it from Ramju, but the elements. And I mentioned this the other day, so I thought I'd flash this up here. The elements earth, water, fire, air, and Akash. The early kingdoms of evolution are connected with earth. That'd be stone, metal, and plants. And the fish kingdom is connected with water. The bird kingdom is connected with air. The animal kingdom, this is in Ramju's book too, I just didn't read that part, is connected with fire. And Baba explains this by saying it's that fire of being hungry or, you know, you see a dog in heat like that energy. And
animals are constantly driven by that sort of passions of race times, and that a human form is all five of them. And just to advert to what we were talking about yesterday, these elements are correlated with the different senses too, which is part of the unfoldment of the human form. Smell, taste, sight, touch, and hearing. This is in Vedanta, in Shankara. Smell is connected with earth, taste with water, sight with fire, touch with wind, and hearing with sankash, or space. So the five primordial elements of the imagination are systematically related to the five senses of the Atman, or the thinking, as it expresses itself through a human form. There's a lot more that could be said about all of these things. I've been just going over this kind of quickly. So that's what I would have to say about the human form and evolution. I don't know anything more about it, but it's apparently a part of the story, the unpacking, unfolding manifestation of the human form as it rises towards the vertical posture. That apparently is significant, to be standing upright. And no other form seems to do that. I'm not aware of any other form that habitually maintains a vertical posture. Do you? The monkeys approach it. But that seems to be part of evolution, standing up. Now, the topic of subtle physiology, I'm going to read from this essay again. Now we're talking about the human form, not just as expressing itself through evolution, but as some kind of a paradigm of some kind, as analogous, as some kind of a model for the cosmos. So I'll just read this paragraph out because it's a little bit small. This is the standard term used, by the way, in this, the people who study this subject. By this expression, we mean to designate those branches of spiritual tradition that deal with the symbolic or archetypal significance of the human form. The idea that the human body itself images or mirrors God can be found in the Torah and runs through the history of Judaic and Christian tradition. In Sufi literature, especially in the work of the perfect master Ibn al-Arabi, the perfect man, perfect human, or al-insan al-kamal, stands as the perfectly mirrored image of God and locus for God's fullest self-disclosure. It's a very central idea in Ibn Arabi. And who is probably the greatest of the Sufi philosophers or theologians. Such conceptions naturally lend themselves to interpretations wherein the human form can be conceived as the microcosm to some larger system or structure as macrocosm. In Hinduism and certain Buddhist traditions as well, the perception that the human form stands as the microcosm to greater domains of spiritual reality has been highly developed through various yogic and meditational lines, such as Kundalini or Laya Yoga or Tantra, whose theory and practice have pervaded the cultural and religious and intellectual milieu of the Indian subcontinent on many levels, particularly since medieval times. Have any of you ever dug into any of this? You know, Kundalini or Tantra or those things?
Kundalini.
Yeah. I mean, the different chakras are, you know, as you rise up through the spinal column, seven chakras culminating here. So the human body seems to be correlated to a certain spiritual progress in that way, flow of energy and prana. Also, in a lot of the yogic traditions, they say there are 72,000 nadis, they're called. A nadi is a stream or a channel. Eva, have you ever gotten into this?
For a pathway. Yeah.
Pathway. And for the flow of prana. In the sukshma sharir, the subtle body, has 72,000 of these channels, they say. Babas, you know, there is a subtle body, and there's probably a subtle physiology. You know, it probably has a structure that our gross body somehow mirrors. And when you just die, your subtle body probably dissociates from the gross body and all those things, yeah.
In every tradition I've struck, the subtle energies depend upon the gross body being in a particularly erect posture.
Huh.
They all insist on the need for that to get the flow of those energies which are particularly human are dependent on that erectness.
Mm. Well, that's interesting, isn't it? Mm. Well,
in Lord Mahesh Baba mentions a bit about the yogis utilizing the vibrations in the air, the energy. The interesting thing is, Baba says, one yogi, one practice, he can only cultivate one city. For example, a yogi who can fly in the air cannot walk on the water. He can only have one type of yogi.
I remember
You remember that?
Yeah. They get carried away with themselves and try to walk on water, they fall in and drown. Medieval and modern Taoist traditions sometimes exhibit the same disposition to map out a microcosmography, a cosmos, right? A cosmography would be the mapping of the cosmos, and a microcosmography is where the structure of the cosmos has been mapped onto the human body. The human body is a miniature representing the entire cosmos. So apparently in Taoist tradition, I got this from you, Tim.
Yeah, particularly internal alchemy.
Internal what?
Alchemy.
Alchemy, yeah. There's a lot of alchemical stuff in India, too, that goes into all of this. A microcosmography, whereby greater cosmological principles get inscribed in the inner landscape of the human body, with its channels and meridians governing the circulation of qi. When Meher Baba touches on these themes, then, he is linking into a vast, sometimes half-subterranean network of interconnecting streams and currents in the great spiritual and esoteric literatures of the world. Now here is a little bit of what some of the indications he himself gave on this topic. Let's see. Zoom to this one again. Yeah. Okay, we're coming. This is the figure that goes with it. And just in brief, he'll say that the navel corresponds. Okay, let me read the passage, which is on the previous page. Get rid of our Vitruvian man there. Okay. This is October 1926. Baba said this to the Mandali. The different degrees of spiritual... Why don't somebody else read another voice? Patricia?
The physical body, prana and man. The different degrees of spiritual advancement can be correlated with different parts of the human body, as explained below. We ordinary people find our place in the physical world, sharir lok, that is in the plum, which is to say in the vicinity of the navel, yindunti, not higher.
And this, you know, in the original manuscript that I had for about 10 years, these words were not filled in. And so I had, and navel was not given there either. So I didn't know what part of the body Baba was talking about, and I went through hell on this until the manuscript showed up at Mirana. And I went, searched heaven and earth to try to figure out what the heck the plum is. And I still don't know. Do any of you know? I mean, I guess it's the navel. Why would that be designated through the word plum?
Well, you know how, what's his name, talked about the del, which is right above
the
del.
Yeah.
There's the other plum, you know, like builders use. The
plumb line.
Plumb line, you know.
It depends, lead.
A lead?
Lead.
I mean, could it be some sort of an image of a human being lying down and
plumb line marks out that.
Yeah, the marks
of that center.
No, in, sorry.
Yeah.
The martial arts, it's just below the navel here, and in Chinese, in the Dantian.
Dantian.
Dantian. And that's where the connection is to the other body, to the astral or to the soul. That's where the connection comes through.
I see.
And it's where you can, in martial arts, that's where you center when you, your key.
John mentions plumb means lead in Latin.
Yeah.
In Taoism, you know, in the beginning was the external alchemy. The two main ingredients, one is lead, the other is mercury.
Yes.
So the main thing is to harmonize them.
Right, those two.
So but still they use that lead for internal alchemy. I wonder if it has anything to do with that.
Yeah. Well, this is a field of study for those who are interested.
Plum also, like John said, the carpenters and the builders use it.
Plum bulb.
To, maintain a balance. Now you spoke about the nadi, that starts from the navel. So when you lay a person down, normally they put their toes together, and if they're not in balance, that means one of your nadi, that's the plumb line which they call, which leads up from the navel.
Yeah.
And they adjust that, and they say, okay, that's the plumb. Which
I was wondering
navel.
At first, because we didn't have the word navel for 10 years, or these words, I'm sorry, Bim Dunti, which nailed it down.
That Duni is called plum in Sanskrit.
We didn't have this at first, so I was wondering if he was talking about the Kundalini and the Muladhara, which would be on the backside, but it sounds like not. I think there is a significance between the front side of the body and the back side of the body, as we'll get to soon.
So there's also a term, Hara.
The hara is 4 fingers below the navel.
Uh-huh.
Because the
hara
chakra,
that's
the one. That's the region what they call the
hara.
That's
the
line.
Below the navel. Okay, you want to carry us up from the navel?
Yogis and such others inhabit the pran lok, and the still more advanced, the man lok or the astral plane. That is, they occupy the upper half of the body from the plumb to the windpipe.
So this whole part of the body is where yogis, and it sounds like we're talking about the first five planes of consciousness.
Sadhgurus occupy the central position between the eyes at the point of what is called the third eye, the Anki Vajrovach. They descend through the lower planes as far as the plumb and ascend back all the way to the Brahman, at the top of the head.
So that's here.
Thus the Sadhgurus inhabit what could be called the junction between the material and the spiritual, the lower and the higher planes.
So that's this point here. Mm-hmm. That's their station. And Majub, okay, we'll get to Majubs now.
And the Majubs in Jivan Mukti abide in the Brahmand, where they enjoy Anand, eternal bliss, retaining no sense or awareness of their gross physical bodies or minds. They are unable to descend from their high station to creation consciousness.
So they're stuck up here. But the Sadhguru who is here can go up, go down as far as the navel, which is where the mass of humanity is.
Prabhupada calls here the door to divinity.
Yeah. So here's the diagram, which we've seen before, just marking all of this. So the junction is here. This would be the sphere of divinity, the crown of the head, the Brahman. And Majub's, actually later he wouldn't have said Jivan Mukti, that would be a Jivan Mukta who's there, but at this time he wasn't so clear about those terms. So this is the Satchitanand state represented for this here. The Sadhguru is at the junction. Sadhguru is at the junction between the real and the illusory, moving down and up between the two at will. And here is, okay. This, between the plum, which is the navel, and the windpipe, this seems to be the yogis in the pranlok, or sphere of energy. And ordinary people are down located right here. So here's some, we're talking about spiritual physiology. Here's an example of it, where Baba is explaining the significance of the body from here to here. And he went back to this, any comments? I don't know anything more about this than what you're reading here. I've never been knowledgeable about physiology or any of these topics, or yoga, or this stuff.
Well, I read a bit about Surya Shambhu yoga, current sound and light, that couple sim, sense couple sim, found that it was one of his seven favorite sense.
Yeah.
He said, according to their particular yoga tradition, they start from the sound, from really the upper.
Yeah.
They start from where pranayama ends, which is the energy somewhere here, the kundalini. So, so obviously it deals with the head part of the energy.
Yes.
Well, he says the pranayama deals with the basic kundalini.
There's some tradition in Hinduism, I think, that has Ganesh as the image to start with, to find your seat in meditation, and that's
the navel. Navel is actually known also as the Om point,
yeah,
the beginning of.
Yeah, Baba does say that.
That's the Om point, from where all creation sprung, through Brahma's navel.
But the Taoists call this the entrance to divinity, call it the heavenly eye. Heavenly heart. The ordinary heart is here, but the heavenly, Tianxin, we call it, heavenly heart is here.
So Baba went back to that same topic about 2 months later. I won't take the time to read it here. He says basically the same thing. But he, let's see, where is this? Okay, I'll go to where I knew it is, which is here. Okay, a year later, actually, I'll just show you these pages. I won't attempt to read from them. But when he was talking to the boys, he explained this stuff to them. These are the, I know they're very faded and very hard to see. I've been busting my eyes.
Is this from still the Rangju, the teachings of Meher?
No, this is Baba's talks to the Maharashram boys. We read yesterday about some of the stuff from Prana Nakash that's there. And these were the, actually, this was the 6th of January, 1928. And by this time, a bunch of them were just out of it. They were experiencing the plains and weeping day and night and all this stuff that had happened right at the end of December. But here he goes through this again. And unfortunately, this talk and the talk of the next day are very garbled, and it's hard to make sense of it. So I here's a sort of a digest of it right here. This is small, so I'll read this out. Here's what he said. The five toes of the foot, they're called fingers, he calls them fingers, I think, and I heard that in India they would use that language to talk about toes. The five toes of the foot, from the small to the big, the Baba explained on that later occasion, correspond to the forms of evolution. The fifth toe, the little pinky toe, between stone and worm, then fish, bird, animal, and human. And thus the achievement of ordinary gross conscious humanity corresponds to the big toe, which Baba in this lecture calls the thumb. From this point, involution begins. The first plane corresponds to the ankle, the second to the knee, the third and fourth to the armpit and some other part of the body. The text appears to be corrupt at this juncture. The fifth to the throat, the sixth to the point between the eyes, and the seventh to the crown of the head.
Baba goes on to explain that the heavens or asmans correspond to the skies, right? As you were saying, the skies. There are, Baba explained that there are planes as you journey up from the gross sphere to God realization. But then there are skies or heavens associated with them. If you go by the, if you travel through the planes, you go very directly. But if you go through the skies, you get almost everyone would get enchanted. And the and he gave an analogy of traveling from Ahmednagar to Bombay by the train. The planes would be like the train stations, and the heavens or skies would be like the cities. If you leave the station and wander around the markets, you'll get beguiled by all the wares on offer there. And that's probably what's happened to musts and people like that. But it seems that there's, in the parts of the body, the different parts of the body correspond to the planes, and there are hollows in the body which correspond to the skies or asmans. And the text is garbled. They didn't record it clearly, so it's hard to make it out. But thus, the first heaven corresponds to the hollow and the sole of the foot. So the ankle is the first plane, and I guess this part of the foot is the heavens associated with it. I think the knee and the maybe the backside is the second plane. So this, in some way, the joint or the protuberance and a space associated with it correspond to the positive and negative, which would be the plane and the asanas. So apparently the human body has this kind of a significance also. So that's in these talks he gave to the boys. I'll just give this much. I haven't really worked with this talk yet. It's very kind of garbled. Yeah.
What doesn't asman also mean planes? Because according to Baba, there are seven asmans, and each one is a plane.
Well, he's differentiating Sata. Between planes and asmans. So he gives it his own very particular usage, where you may not have been here the other day, but we went through some of the heavens associated with the planes, and they're different. For example, the first plane has three asmans, three skies associated with it. The second plane has two. The third plane has three. The fourth plane has one only, like that.
Well, I think in God Speaks, doesn't he use planes as the... Because doesn't he talk about people getting caught up in the planes rather than...
Yes, he didn't clarify this point in God Speaks, that there are in fact heavens, so he used planes as a very encompassing term and didn't go into these details.
It seemed like the plane being a horizontal
right.
thing it would be a neater way to describe the exploration of a level.
Right. So like in the third plane, there's the hayrat, the state of enchantment, where you can get caught. Whereas I think that in reality, it's not the plane, but the sky where that happens. But he was describing it in a simple way in God Speaks. He didn't get into a lot of these finer points. He hadn't explained that since the 1920s.
Actually, in the Nadi and everything, Baba gave a very clear description of the planes and the worlds.
Mm. Oh, those worlds, planes, skies.
Yeah. And then you've got Rhino Galley's painting of the, you know, the chart, the big chart.
In the birthday
cake? The planes, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes, right. That shows the
different planes. People on them, yeah.
And it doesn't give any distinction between planes and skies or anything like that. Baba really didn't talk about that from the time the Westerners showed up.
Yeah.
He sort of dropped the subject. There are a lot of things he dropped.
Okay.
I don't know. I guess it's a refinement that wasn't, he didn't want to go into it or something.
Yeah, he knew the Westerners and I don't know.
But when Baba asked Francis to do a new edition of God Speaks, is a possibility he may have given Francis points to add that plans and
well, there are, among the points we have, there is nothing like this. So if he wanted Francis to add it, he hadn't gotten to it yet, apparently. There's nothing of that kind there. So let me see. Now there are other dimensions to this topic too. Let's see. Okay, I'll just show this and won't try to read all of this, but the circles of the Sadhguru, and presumably this would also be true of Avatar, but he wasn't talking about Avatar in those days. Have a correspondence with parts of the human body also. Now here's what, here's a new esoteric fact that comes out actually in this Tiffin lecture that will be coming out later this year. The Sadhguru has a circle of 12, as probably a lot of you know who have read the discourses on that subject. Later on he explained it's 12 plus 2, but he didn't mention the plus 2 then. The plus 2 were over on the women's side, with whom the men had no contact in those days. He was just talking to the men at this time. But he also said this, the 12 disciples of a Sadhguru, one of them goes out and is gone. And Baba didn't explain what that meant. And after that, he only talks about 11 that are functionally relevant to the work of a Sadhguru. And he said that he, at one point he dies, or makes me think of Judas. Is it the Judas role or something like that? But it's not just in this Tiffin lecture, but in several others, he'll talk about the circle of 11. And at first I thought it was a mistake, but it's not. There's one of them's gone, is out of the picture. And one of them is a chargeman, Baba said. That is to say, the Sadhguru has a chargeman who then becomes the next Sadhguru in time. Okay, so we have this business of 11. And these, he said that these circle members correspond to different parts of the Sadhguru's body. He said this in one of the discourses too. Now, let's see where this is. I have this somewhere. Yeah, I know this is a little bit hard to read, but this is the kind of material we're talking about. And now this also gives another esoteric fact we hadn't heard before either. You may have heard that there are always 56 God-realized souls in creation at all times. That's part of the structure of the hierarchy, I guess you could say. 5 Sadhgurus and 51 others. Apparently, the Sadhguru, each Sadhguru has a circle of 56 also. There's a circle of 11, and there's an outer circle of 56. And it may not be this slide, it may be... this one talks about it. And I transcribed it somewhere. Let's see. The one universal, this is a literal transcription, through 56 works. Okay, of these 56, 5 are Sadhgurus. This is the body of 56 in the entire universe. 51 Satpurushas, that's God-realized souls of various sorts. But all are realized, nay, Saliks, Acharyas, with the duty assigned to each. Each of these 56 have 56 in their alag-alag circle. And alag-alag means separate-separate. So each of the 56 God-realized souls has his own circle of 56. And in one place, they even do the multiplication. 56 times 56 is 2,800 and whatever it is, something like that. So he really meant it, that each of the 56 has a circle of 56. But they're not all God realized. Of these 56, 11 are masters, are God realized. 11 are seers, this would be highly advanced. Seers from a distance, being pushed forward towards the goal. 3 are dead, and what is a maju?
Why? Like found them.
They're dead, I know. They're dead, but they still won't let go, man. I'm not giving up my office just because I died.
Yeah. So another doesn't, one doesn't pop in when the three die. You don't get three new ones coming. That's it, finished.
Apparently not. Well, it seems so. They try their ghosts, their ghouls come after you and drive you off. And now, these 56, Baba says in the Tikkun, all right, the 56 of a Sadhguru correspond, he says, to 56 parts of the body. Now, he didn't say what those 56 parts of the body are, but he did say that the 11 of the inner circle also correspond to parts of the body. And here we actually get, I'll just show you where it was originally. It's right down here. Yes.
Across the universe or just on Earth?
It's only on Earth that you get God-realized people. Nowhere else. Everywhere else they're chugging along, these brainy people inventing new scientific devices and stuff like that. Evolution. Involution occurs only on this earth. You have to come here for that. Liz?
Well, those numbers don't add up to 56.
So it doesn't say that it goes there. In that number there are.
Yeah, but what are the other
remaining? Yeah, I think he left.
Mystery.
I think he left out one group of
11. Mystery bags.
I've forgotten. I puzzled that one through at one point. Yeah, these are Chanji's notes and there are mistakes all over the place. So that's one of them.
Maybe there are more dead ones.
He does have another account where he sorts it out. Actually, there's one place, in fact, I think it's this one here. 11, 11, 11, 11, 1. And what this is, and here you have it right here, the 56, you know, the 5 and the 51, and each one of those has a circle of 56. And it would seem from this page, and maybe somewhere else, that, you know, the body of 56 God-realized souls, that they include the 5 Sadhgurus, at least 51, then the 10 remaining ones of each circle, because the 12th went out and was gone out of the picture. So that gets us up to 55, and then there's a Maju, that's what he says. So the fellow circle members of the Sadhguru are part of this body of 56, apparently. And it would seem that if there are 56, all of this is related to the actual human form. See, all these things seem to be connected with each other. But he didn't say what those 56 parts of the human body are. We need some master spiritual physiologists to come along who understand these things, or yogis or stuff like this, who will take this further. But this is then what he says about the 11. Okay, we have the outer circle of 56. And we have the inner circle of 11 because the 12th left. And the 11 indicate 11 different parts of the human body. 2 eyes, 2 ears, 2 nostrils, 2 hands, 2 feet, a nose.
It can't be a nose. You've got already nostrils. Either mouth or the trunk of the body.
Yeah, so it's obviously, Chanji is writing fast like this. Now, he doesn't mention, we actually get another version of this in one of the discourses, as you may recall. And where do I have that here somewhere, too. Yes. I don't have I just transcribed it, not the copy of the original. Let's see. Okay, since Baba is attributing the same kind of significance to the body parts of the ordinary man, as he did in the Chikun lectures with Sadhguru, perhaps what he is ultimately referring to is the universal man, the archetypal human form that underlies every form in creation.
And this, okay, I don't think I have the right part.
Yes, important. Two eyes.
Yes, okay. Right, okay. In the very same 14 Bardi parts named in the Mirror Message article, he names them there in one of these Mirror Message articles, this would be in the 1920s or early 30s, appeared again a quarter of a century later in a discourse published in the Awakener magazine in 1954 and subsequently republished in the 7th and revised 6th edition of the discourses. And by the way, if you're going to read that particular discourse, and if you get interested in this topic, it would be better to read the reprinting of it in the revised 6th edition of the discourses, or else in its original publication in the Awakener magazine, because they kind of tweaked it a little bit in the 7th edition. Okay, I won't go into it. It's like a needlessly worrying about it. Small point. Yeah, political correctness jumped in and hit, obscured some of the facts of it, apparently. So I would go to this version, in the revised 6th edition of the discourse. In that discourse, Baba compared the 14 members of the Avatar's inner circle, that is, the 12 primary circle members in the two appendages, with the human body parts as follows. Two eyes, two ears, two nostrils, one mouth, two hands, two legs, and the trunk of the body itself, plus the external genitals and anus that act as the appendage to the body as a whole. Though Baba does not explicitly say so, what applies here to the inner circle of the Avatar doubtless applies to the circle of the Perfect Master, which according to this same article, similarly includes 14 members, 12 plus 2. So what this suggests to me is that what is true of the Avatar and what is true of the primordial human form. There is this significance to it. The human form has this meaningfulness, a relationship to the basic structure of the Avatar. So here we see about the 14, 12 plus 2 parts of the body and their relationship to the circle of the Avatar. But apparently the number 56 is there too. So if any of you are able to work it out, please let the rest of us know what those 56 parts would be. Any thoughts or comments at this point? I've kind of reached them. Yeah.
Remember in the Tikkun Shandeja, Baba gave a riddle to his disciples. He said, what is 5 minus 7 equals 12. Remember that riddle? Mm-hmm. He said five is, the human being is made up of 5 elements, a word was from the traditional Hindu elements. Then when the human being starts on the spiritual plane, has to go to through the 7 planes. Through each plane, he drops 1 thing, so that means minus 7. Then equals 12, then he becomes perfect. The Perfect Master is made up of 12 paths, which are his circle.
Yeah.
So that's why 5 minus 7 equals 12.
Yeah.
So actually, Baba says the Perfect Master is made up of
12
circles.
Yeah. Yeah. Here's, when we get to God Speaks, let me see. Yeah, now here's a major statement of this general theme. This is in the chapter, The Sevenfold Veil. Baba says, let's have someone else say. Anyone want to read this out?
The last major discussion in Mayor Baba's writings appertaining to spiritual physiology occurs in the 7th chapter of God Speaks, entitled The Sevenfold Veil. Here Baba develops at some length an analogy in which the curtain blocking the sight of God's face is compared to a veil with 7 folds. Analogically, it is true that man is made in the image of God. The top of his head represents the Vidyan Bhumika Arshyala, the highest spiritual state, or the seat of Brahman. The forehead corresponds to the entrance to divinity. The center of the forehead, just above the two external eyes, is the seat of the inner or third eye. When the veil with all its seven folds is finally removed, man is then able, through the third eye, to see God face to face, and sees him more actually and naturally than what he is ordinarily able to see of his body in the world through the two external eyes. In order to arrive at the divine entrance situated in the forehead, man has to pass through the seven doors as represented by the seven physical openings in the face.
Okay, and let's see. Keep
on. The seven openings in the face, as Baba goes on to enumerate, are the mouth, right nostril, right ear, left ear, right eye, and left eye. Entering through the door of the mouth, one arrives on the first plane. The passage inwards through the right and left nostrils, respectively, brings one to the second and third planes. The entry through the right and left ears and through the right and left eyes are both two-in-one achievements that lead one, respectively, to the fourth and fifth planes.
So you have to go in through both ears, one and then the other, to get to the fourth plane, and you have to go in through both eyes, one and then the other. And I guess the right comes first and the left comes second, it sounds like it, to get to the fifth plane.
Plainly, the human physiognomy has a symbolic or archetypal significance. One notes further that the seven openings of the face referred to in God Speaks number among the 14 parts of the body discussed in the Mare Message and Awakener articles cited above.
Okay, now here's, Baba says, we went into this briefly the other day, but to look at it again, about what happens, now where is my thing? Yeah, as you, when you're going through the path and you're dealing with these parts of the face. Let's see, there we go. This is this chapter, the Sevenfold Veil. And, okay, we just looked at this. Okay. Seven doors. Okay, do you want to read this paragraph out to Jim? Or are you?
Where it starts, when?
When?
When an initiate succeeds in actually entering the divine path, it is for him a single seven-in-one achievement, and it applies to the first of the seven folds of the veil, viz. Number one, unfastening of the first knot. Number two, disappearance of the first fold. Number three, crushing out of the first root desires. Number four, wiping out of the relative fundamental impressions. Number five, doing away with the first of the seven deep dark colors. Number six, entrance through the first door as represented by the mouth. And seven, arriving on the first plane in the subtle sphere, the Pran Vivan or the Alam E Malakut.
Yeah, this would be the Urdu Islamic term for it. So this happens with each of the seven folds, apparently. So I guess the image Baba is giving is like a curtain that has these folds in it. And they're tied with a knot somehow. I'm not very good at this sort of thing, but somehow there's a knot tying them up. And you untie the knot, and then the fold disappears, and then you crush. I don't fully understand all of this, but you crush out the first of the root desires. There are conventionally said to be seven root desires. And once again, I don't know exactly what they are. Baba always says lust, greed, and anger, etc. So,
yeah,
the
first one in Buddhism is lust.
Yeah. And in one place, Baba correlates lust, greed, and anger with the gross, subtle, and mental spheres, respectively. So, how we get some, anyway, but apparently there are seven. And then the fundamental impressions. I mean, I guess these are different steps. There's a color associated. What are the seven main colors? Do we know?
The first one, red.
Red. Are there seven primary colors? I'd love to have the idea that.
Violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red.
Say those louder.
Violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red.
Yeah.
You asked for seven colors.
Father changed the seventh one of blue. The seventh and the sixth. He said, put a blue on the top. He does talk with a blue as a mentor or something.
Yeah, there's a little bit on colors in one of the Tiffin lectures where he says actually the green is the
spiritual.
Highest color.
It's so green is a spiritual color.
It represents
longing.
It's a very deep like the color of longing, and longing for God is green, apparently. And the ordinary sanskaras, these are colors of sanskaras, ordinary sanskaras that are neither particularly good or bad or blue. If you perform an action of that type, you acquire a deep, dark blue colored sanskara. But if you simply experience the sanskara mentally and don't act it, it's a light blue. And lust and anger are red. And again, light red, a deep, dark red, or a light red, depending on whether you act it out or don't. Mm-hmm. So I guess maybe this has something to do with this too. But then it seems like all of this is moving towards actually entering in through the opening of the face. And once you do so, you arrive at the plane in question. So it would seem that you need to actually, I mean, this is what comes to my mind. We're looking the wrong way. We're looking out. And we should be looking in. You see, this human form really is significant. So to enter into the spiritual path, you have to stop looking out and start looking in. And to do so, you actually have to go back in through the openings of the face. And it's as if you had a sort of a rubber mask, and you've got to kind of grab it and turn it inside out, or outside in, or whatever it is. And you do it by going in through the, and this would be the primary organ of taste. And then you go in through the next two, the nostrils would be the primary organs of scent, smell. And then you go in through the primary organs of hearing. And then you go in through the primary organs of sight. And the three senses that remain in the subtle sphere are, in fact, smell, hearing, and sight. Yeah?
It's referred to, like entering the spiritual path, it's referred to as the turning.
Right.
So there was that thing Francis refers to as the turn.
Right.
And in his poem.
He uses that word a lot.
Yes.
In one of these talks, the Tiffin Lecture talks, this is in La Navla, and they had been in a hall, and they came outside, and there were three steps to it, and Baba was sitting there, and he gave the analogy. People of the world are like, let's suppose Baba's room here is, there are three steps, are like facing, Paramatma is behind them, but they're facing outward towards the gross world. Yogis are actually facing inward, but they don't have what it takes to go in. They haven't entered in yet. But what you actually need to do is turn from the world towards Paramatma, climb the three steps, which would be the gross, subtle, mental worlds. And when you step inside, which I guess Baba did with all his mandali, there happened to be three garments hanging on the wall from hooks. And Baba said, these are Satchit and Anand. Then you experience Satchit and Anand. Give that analogy for this whole process.
He used the word tan a lot in explanations to the boys.
Mm-hmm.
He even said, he hasn't turned.
Yes.
Once he's turned.
Right. And boy, this is a fundamental turning, isn't it? Where you actually go in through your mouth, mm-hmm. go in through your nostrils, your consciousness actually does that. And this is the whole process. I guess these are spent time with this chapter, and I guess he's describing here, I mean, this is like an analogy of a veil, and he's using figures of knots and folds and colors. But I presume he must be referring to what people on the plains actually experience. Getting rid of the color, getting rid of the impressions that are all collected in that fold. There are probably a zillion impressions from all these lifetimes.
getting rid of them all.
But these seven things relate to the aspirant just entering the path or the planes. So does that, and that's the first fold.
You do
so
the same thing.
Every fold, the same thing.
Yeah. You do the same thing with all. Oh. All of them, yeah. And the seven things.
Only the first five planes, not the seven planes.
You get rid of the seven folds completely by the time you reach the fifth plane. Oh. So when you go to the fourth plane, you do two folds, and it's a two-fold achievement. It's two, seven, and one. And when you go to the fifth plane, you go in through both eyes, and each one of them entails these seven steps. So by the time you've got to the fifth plane, all the veil, all the folds are gone.
But when the veil is unveiled, taken off, then you sight God face to face, and the sixth plane.
Yes.
In Judaism, the tzitzit are the seven threads on
yes.
the four corners of the undergarment.
Yes.
But there's an eighth which ties the knot, so each knot has to be untied to release the folds of the threads,
huh.
and that's the fourth, then you enter into the fifth plane. But I'm reminded of that,
huh.
I don't know who this is, somebody will remember, recall it, that one of the, a man was trying to enter into the first plane, he ate the porridge, regurgitated it 40 times, took away that, lust for it, and he entered the first plane.
Huh.
It was in
Barbara's book on questions and answers.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember Eric saying one time, Baba sent him to different spiritual figures, and one of them, does somebody remember this, vomited up food he had eaten and offered it to Eric. And Eric said, he went and had and ate it, expecting the worst. And in fact, it was delicious. So maybe when you actually do these movements inward, a lot of these things, your food changes too. So this chapter on God Speaks, which uses the Sufi figure of the veil, is centered on spiritual physiology. One piece of it, that is the openings of the face. And some of the stuff in the 20s, as I mentioned yesterday, Baba does indicate, you know, when prana and akash, you know, split and clash and combine to form, our forms are a combination of those two. Prana eventually, as it develops, comprises the inner worlds. He called them the subtle in those days. That means the six planes, not subtle, cum mental. So prana, energy, turns into the inner world. And akash, or space, or emptiness, becomes the gross form. And we were saying yesterday how the bubble, it seems to me the bubble is a nice figure for that, where the emptiness is what makes, where there's nothing, air, but let's say nothing for our analogy. It's empty inside, that's like the akash. And the bubbleness is comprised of the water, which is actually the drop. So you have the combination of prana and akash there. And so prana comprises the subtle sphere, and akash winds up evolving into the gross sphere. And Baba said that this corresponds in the human body to what is above the neck and what is below it. The subtle means inner world, subtle cum mental, is from here up. And the gross is from here down. And notice that the circle, as described in that discourse, has seven parts are above the neck and seven parts are below. And the seven that he talks about in the discourse above the neck are these very seven. The mouth, the two nostrils, the two ears, and the two eyes, they're all openings. And the seven below are the two arms, the two legs, the trunk of the body, the genitals, and the anus. So there are, in fact, 14 parts. The gross and the subtle. So here's another way in which the human body is an archetype. It's sort of the whole cosmos is represented in it. Now I wanted to sing the last topic. Well, actually, there's a lot more we could talk about. But talk about the. I'll just flash these slides and not move on them. Yeah.
How many of these Tiflin lectures are there? Oh, you may have already mentioned, I don't know.
It's a book of them, and there are 52.
Oh.
It talks to the Mandalay. They're on all sorts of different topics. But if we're talking about, this isn't the human, this is like the inner structure of the human being, not the external human form. So I'm just going to refer you to it. If you want to know what your parts are, the layers of yourself, the Indian term would be koshas. This would be for the ordinary gross conscious person. You have at the core the soul, then you have consciousness as the first layer. The next would be the seat of individuality. The next would be the sanskaras. You see, these are rings. If you put these two together, the seat of individuality and the sanskaras, you get the ego. So there's a formal, we can spend a whole weekend just on this one chart. I'm giving you two just in brief. This is coming from the inner out, inside out. As you get further out, you get the intellect. In animals, it's instinct. The next layer is the mental body, and these two together, the intellect and the mental body, comprise mind. Intellect would be buddhi in the Indian language. Then you get the subtle body, and then you get the gross body. So this would be well worth studying. I'm sure psychologists in the future will devote a lot of attention to this. But the Baba goes on to show what that is like for people on the first to third planes and the illumined souls of the mental planes. But here we get his representation of the perfect one, who also has seven layers. You'll see this was given in 1943 in the Divine Theme, and exactly this same image appears in the 10 States of God in that chart there. It's exactly the same. So here, this is what the perfect one, let's say the Sadguru and the Avatar. I don't know what the Jiva and Mukta looks like. Maybe they're kind of bleached out, or they don't have some of these, or, and the Maju is probably, actually he has said something about this. So anyway, so this is Baba. This is what Baba looks like, if you could see the different layers of his being. Gross body. The next is subtle body. The next is mental body. Okay, that's normal. We've all got those. Now it starts to get different. We have a universal body as the fourth layer. We have a universal mind as the fifth layer. Then an unlimited divine ego as the next layer. And then infinite consciousness. And if we were spending more time on this, we could say a lot. But one thought that occurs to me is like, why did Baba sometimes seem not to know things? You know, why did he exhibit human ignorance? He seems, although I fully believe that he was infinite knowledge, why did he spell infinite, I-N-F-I-N-A-T-E, instead of the correct spelling according to all the dictionaries that I know, or ordinary, O-R-D-I-N-E-R-Y, you know? Why did he misspell words? These are just sort of trivial examples, but these are questions the world will come.
It's like Catholic schooling.
Yeah. The Catholics are to blame.
Well,
what occurs to me is that we're talking about the mental body of Marwan Shariyarani, which was the mental body of an ordinary man in his own way. But if he had wanted to access universal mind or universal body or those things, he would have. And he did so when he was working in those ways. So when we're talking about the avatar, the point from which an action proceeds might flash around, you know. Yeah.
Erich explained it, to a certain degree, and he said that in order to make people feel comfortable,
that he would be natural. He would ask, you know, even the baby, yeah, that he could see what sex it was, you know.
Boy or girl.
It's a boy or girl.
Stark naked baby as well. Is it a boy or a girl?
So he would, that was, I heard Erich mention that one of the things,
yeah,
he thought, just this was Erich's opinion,
yeah,
was it to put people at ease,
yeah,
and to make them feel natural.
Yeah.
Because had been with someone who knew everything would be very off-putting.
Yeah, be frightening. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the avatar, a sadguru, goes up from man's state, from human condition, to become God. But the avatar is going the other way, actually descending into human form, and really and truly becomes man. Baba says that, and God speaks in a number of the passages I have on these slides we won't get to. So there's actually a becoming of this. So, you know, like Meher Baba was, what, 5 foot?
Six.
He wasn't 7 foot two, like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and might not always have been able to slam dunk a basketball, even though he was infinite power. There were, as a human being, he had limitations in these sorts of ways, and he accepted that those were part of the work of becoming man.
Where does it say that? I remember that he said, the perfect masters act the part that the avatar becomes.
I think,
yeah,
it's in the everything or nothing. There's something called knowing and not knowing.
Uh-huh. Is it there? It's right in God Speaks. All of this. In fact, I have the slides here. I'm just thinking, I won't read them now. But he says that, yeah, the perfect master acts the part because the perfect master has actually become God from human state. Whereas, so thus a perfect master will act being sick, act it to perfection. But the avatar is actually God become man, really becomes it, and really becomes sick. That's right there in God Speaks. And this thought occurs to me. There are some very, I'll just show you what are some of the passages germane to this in God Speaks. Who gets to this? Let me see. Yes. I'm going to have to scan that one. Let's see where this is. Here, let me just take a minute and find it in my notes. Yeah. If you want to read this about the avatar, it starts...
Number 30.
48. Yeah, it starts. Yeah, he starts talking in this whole section about page 148. Five sadgurus, and then the next page he'll get, I think he gets to the difference between the...
the difference between the divine
status. Yeah, between the divine status. Okay. Yeah, the difference between the divine status of Kutub or sadguru, the avatar of the age, is that a Kutub, after having gone through the whole process of cosmic evolution, enters and lives the life of God as man-god, while the avatar doesn't have to go through that. And both are living the life of God. Let's see.
It's in the supplement, number 30.
Yeah, number 28, 29, 30, and 33 are all significantly becoming both are simultaneous. In spite of this, the most important and only difference is the Kutub acts on that level, and the avatar becomes on that level. To make the point of acting and becoming clear, many and innumerable examples can be quoted, but for ordinary human understanding, let illness serve as an example. For instance, the Kutu or Sadguru cannot and will not fall ill. And when he appears to have fallen ill, it is just his acting of an illness. When people actually see him ill, they do not see him ill, but in reality they see his illness perfectly enacted, because he is the perfect master and perfection personified. He acts as if he were ill. On the other hand, when people see the avatar ill, he has actually fallen ill, and he has literally become ill. But though the avatar has actually become ill, he has at his back simultaneously infinite power, infinite knowledge, infinite bliss. Mm-hmm. So this is a very good statement, mm-hmm. that difference, that distinction.
That's page 150, is that what you
see? Yeah, 150, 150, yeah. Right. And there are several pages where he goes, says a lot more about the avatar. In the supplement, there are some very interesting discussions of this. Here would be one, the advent of the avatar. By the way, there's a discourse in Beings on the Spiritual Panorama, very relevant to all of this also. But, and the avatar and the Sadhguru. Let's see. Interesting which we actually looked at this. Well, let's just read this out. Anyone want to read this out?
The sense Madhubhava wishes to convey is, when a Sadhguru is said to be in good health or ill, all this is said and seen and felt by ordinary human beings. The underlying truth from the point of view of the Sadhguru is that neither good health nor illness nor anything whatsoever affects, touches his being, infinity, in the least, because he is perfectly conscious, fully aware of illusion as illusory, and is thus fully aware that health and illness are both illusory, i.e. they are the outcome of the nothing. How could the nothing ever affect you? The Sadhguru has overcome the impressions of nothing through the process of evolution, reincarnation, and involution, and he has realized that he is the everything, which of course includes the nothing. Even though the Sadhguru remains within the law of creation, the law itself does not touch him. Sadhguru means that man has become God. Therefore, when man has become God, he can no longer be man. And if he has to live as man, he has to act, behave, and appear like a man by spontaneously putting into action, that is demonstrating, all the natural tendencies of man. Being a perfect master, the Sadhguru enacts the part or plays the role or lives through the role so perfectly on all levels and in all planes that under all circumstances and in all other respects, he appears to ordinary human beings as if he were a man amongst men of the gross world. He also appears as if he were one of the men in the subtle planes for those who are in the subtle planes. And to those who are in the mental planes, he appears as if he were one of them. The Sadhguru is simultaneously on the level of the lowest and of the highest. On the one hand, he is established in infinite reality, and on the other hand, he is the master of illusion. Thus, the Sadhguru has under his sway the two extremes, and reconcilement between the two extremes could only be established and maintained throughout all intermediary stages and states by the Sadhguru acting on all planes and on all levels simultaneously.
Okay, so that's the Sadhguru. And now he's going to explain the avatar is different from that. Okay?
In the case of the avatar, the story is quite different. All the difference is contained in the fact that the Sadhguru means man becoming God, while avatar means God becoming man. It is very difficult to grasp the entire meaning of the word avatar. For mankind, it is easy and simple to declare that the avatar is God, and that it means that God becomes man. But this is not all that the word avatar means or conveys. It would be more appropriate to say that the avatar is God, and that God becomes man for all mankind, and simultaneously, God also becomes a sparrow for all sparrows in creation, an ant for all ants in creation, a pig
for all things in creation, a particle of dust for all dusts in creation, a particle of air for all air that's in creation, etc. For each and everything that is in creation. When the five sadgurus affect the presentation of the divinity of God into illusion, this divinity pervades the illusion in effect and presents itself in innumerable varieties of forms, gross, subtle, and mental. Consequently, in avataric periods, God mingles with mankind as man and with the world of ants as an ant, etc. But the man of the world cannot perceive this and hence simply says that God has become man and remains satisfied with this understanding in his own world of mankind.
Okay. Now, one of the thoughts that comes to me in dealing with all this material of spiritual physiology is that if there's one form in creation, we've read that a number of times, and every form is actually a fractile, I'll use that, you know, fractiles, and that a instance, a variation, a derivation of that one form in creation. Well, perhaps what happens in the avataric advent is the avatar becomes that archetypal one form, so that he actually is everyone and everything, because we are all just that one form. That's what that. So I had always thought when the avatar is everyone and everyone, I sort of thought of it as in the depth of me, if you get to my Atman, to my, that drop that is the real me, he's there. Okay, well, that's true. But perhaps in the case of the avatar, it's more than that. He is becoming our very formality also, like all these parts of the body which have their significance. When he becomes that archetypal, the Alansan al-Kamal, the primal, the perfect man, he becomes that form that informs us. He's my fingertip, he's my toe. Because all of those, so when Baba is sitting in the chair and he's doing this with his fingers, in some way he's doing that within absolutely everyone, not just at the soul level, but all the way out to our surfaces too. And somehow the avatar means that. So like when he says he becomes an ant for an ant, sometimes people have said, is there an avataric ant, you know? I don't think it means that. But we were seeing yesterday how, you know, there's a there's a universal stone form, and there are individual stone forms. There's a universal plant form and individual plant forms. I don't know if you remember that quotation from Infinite Intelligence. So by becoming that universal perfect man, Al-Insan Al-Kamal, he would become all of those things, actually. And every one would be a instance of it, or a participatory living out of it in some sort of way. Anyway, does that make any sense? That thought occurs to me. I somehow think that that must be true, even though I don't know about whoever said that.
Baba makes a distinction between the perfect master's experience of God and the avatar. The discourse, Baba says, the perfect master, the man becoming God, they see God in everyone and everything. But the avatar sees himself in everyone.
Yeah. It does make sense. I mean, it's like a perfect master having risen from the bottom up. He's kind of gone out of it. And coming back, it's not as full a return. But the avatar is actually descending down and really invests and fills and becomes it. Nonetheless, despite this difference between the avatar and the perfect master, the tenth state of God is common to both of them, and it's represented the same way in that chart of the tenth state of God. But since our time is really up here, I wanted to show, this is the Sufi concept. This is the word used, al-insan al-kamal, al-insan al-kamal. Insan means man, and Kamal means perfect. And this was a very big idea that emerged 1100, 1200, over those centuries, where, and I'll quickly
explain what these things are. This would be something like the beyond state of God. This would be something like the beyond state, okay, states one and two. If we had time, I could explain this fully. This, actually, you'll see a lot of this in the supplement to God Speaks and in chart 11. You'll see a whole series of five things, five unities, five this and five that. It's these five. Okay. This is something like the mental sphere. This is something like the subtle sphere, and this is the gross sphere. In fact, it's called subtle and gross sphere. This world of spirits, alame jabrut, would be the mental sphere. So this is actually familiar to us. Gross, subtle, mental, God beyond, and God beyond beyond. Well, it's said in by some of the great Sufi masters, Ibn Arabi, and later expositors of that tradition, that the perfect man, al-insan, al-kamal, encompasses all of them and spans them all. So in that sense, the perfect man is greater than Allah. This would be Allah. Baba would say that sometimes. Mm-hmm. Who is greater, Tukaram, Bhagwan or Tukaram? You know, who is greater, Ahura Mazda or Zoroaster? And the answer is Zoroaster, because Ahura Mazda is up there and is with no help. But Zoroaster encompasses the bridges. And this is really what Barzakh means. We use it in this very limited way in the Baba world. But it really means this, the one who links and combines all parts of the entire order from God to creation. It's all linked and spanned by Al-Insan Al-Kamal. And I think that would be the avatar, and that would be the perfect master, the 10th state of God. And we will be talking about the 10 states of God this afternoon. Thank you.